Welcome back to The Real Grind, guys. We are here back where we talk about real estate while we sip on the best cup of coffees, which is two awesome passions of mine. I say this all, you're gonna be tired of me and Italo talking about coffee and real estate, man. And we try to bring one of the best speakers, people there have done it, that they started it and just took action. And now they're killing in this industry.
Absolutely. And like you said, people are gonna get tired of us talking about coffee, real estate. But you know what's interesting about coffee?
What?
Have you ever shared a cup of coffee with somebody that you don't really want to talk to them?
No, because when they said, there's a few of those folks, right, we get those calls like, hey, let's go for coffee. And I was like, oh man, not even a call. What about a phone call, right?
That could be a text, right?
We can do it, everything we're doing in coffee and a phone call.
Yeah, absolutely. And, right? and here on the show, that's when it's different. Hey, can you text? Why don't you come here and have a cup of coffee with us,
right? You know, the VIP people here come to our office and they come here in the studio and they get treated well. You get a mug, you'll get sit there and eat those coffee. He can geek out for hours about coffee if you want to. You
know, I'm probably going to need to pay rent because I'm gonna talk your ears off for hours. So, but yeah, I would love to talk coffee with people. I love having people here on the show talk coffee, real estate, and just geek out on both subjects. It's amazing.
And today we had an awesome guest that's gonna come in on the show and talk about his journey. He has his hands in multiple successful businesses and we can't wait to learn and hear his story. But before, let's get that show started. Real Grind.
Waking up to success, now we're getting it started. This is the real grind. Everything you've been wanting, building an empire, no question. Talking about real estate, investing, making the millions, no stopping. While we sip on, go and make coffee. The real grind. This is the real grind. Let's go.
All right. He has been investing in real estate for the past 16 years, from a single family flipping to now multifamily with over 8,000 units, dude. Founder and CEO of Elevate Commercial Investment Group. Father of three beautiful daughters and a husband. We're walking on the stage, George Abreu. Let's go. Let's go, man. Dude, how many years now I know you for? Like probably about 4 or 5 years.
That's what I was thinking, right around there.
Yeah. And I know that you already been invested before, but like when I met you, you were on the construction side, and like I saw the other day you posted a picture. No, that's so cool because when people actually now see that beginning right there. And like where you are now, like an investor, you got your mentorship, your mastermind, you're vertically integrated, dude. Like, let's get into it, man.
Yeah. I mean, it's a lot of the stuff happened behind the scenes, right? Even when you met me, it seemed like I was there for the construction company, but
of course not.
In the background, I was, you know, working, obviously working the construction company, but also working the investments.
Absolutely. And George, but let's go farther back. Where are you from? What's your beginnings? Let's get there.
So I'm originally from Miami, Florida. Parents are both Cuban. They came over during the Peter Pan. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but
yes.
A lot of children came from Cuba to Miami. So, you know, I grew up, obviously, Hispanic family and that culture, which a lot of the Cubans that came over in that time became business owners. So I think that kind of got engraved in me.
The entrepreneurship early ages.
Yes.
The young hustler.
You know, the opportunity to come to the States and get away from, the hardships of
was
Cuba.
Florida, Miami?
Miami, Florida.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, it's a pretty crazy Miami, right? Very fast paced and, definitely had a good time living over there and learned a lot. And I started my real estate in 2006. I quit my W-2 and started doing full-time real estate. Back then, it was single family. Did a lot of fix and flips and had a lot of success. And then the market just exploded.
Yep.
2008. And that's when I looked at the prices were dropping so low in Miami, you know, both coasts pretty much, West Coast and East Coast. So I started looking at other places. We looked at Phoenix and Dallas, decided to make the move to Dallas. And
thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Thanks for coming here.
Yep. And, kept doing the real estate, started making a little transition to like small multi and had a started building a portfolio of rentals. I didn't love the management part of it, to be honest with you. And it was the not having the scale, the small amount of, you know, small multi and single family. And it was a pain. And couldn't find a good manager to, you know, take it on. So we were doing a lot of the door knocking and asking for rents. And
don't get me started, bro. Yeah. But yeah, I understand the pain.
So as the market heated up, right, you know, the market got pretty darn hot here in Dallas for sure.
Right.
We sold all of that and started going back to the fix and flips. At that point, I had started my own construction company as well to bring that in-house and scale. So we started getting pretty creative with our fix and flips.
Which for that industry and the fix and flip, man, a majority of people that try to get into it and they don't know a construction background, it is. Your chances increases so much of to a...
Yeah, it's easy to get burned. I mean, we got burned in the journey.
We got burned, exactly. Yeah. So, you know, to have that experience, that is key, man, you know, to be creative and having your own crew to have enough volume.
Yep.
So talk a little bit about us, about the flipping side of it, you know, when you started it. Were you buying more as a portfolio, just house to house and auctions? Or what?
Yeah, I mean, it changed as the market changed, right? Sure. When we moved here to Dallas, it was a lot of foreclosures, some short sales, foreclosures, and at that point we were building the portfolio because we couldn't really turn around and sell those quickly, for the most part. But we were buying them cheap, you know. We knew we were going in at a really low basis, and then as that market heated up, like I said, you know, we ended up selling all those, had a lot of equity in them, and then really just started riding the wave up on the market and doing the fix and flips and started scraping. You know, adding second stories to the point where we just started scraping the houses all together and building them new. And then started building some small multifamily. Eventually, about 7 to 6 years ago, I discovered syndications,
larger multifamilies, the holy grail.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, the whole, before that, 11, 12 years of real estate, my whole goal was to scale. And boom, I mean, it just hit me like light bulb went off and I'm like, this is where I need to be. So sold all my single family again and started transitioning over to large multifamily. And that's all we've been focused on for the last 7 or so years.
Man, that's amazing, dude. I like that big portfolio now. Like, you know, it's incredible.
Yep.
And in a short period of time, you know, like pretty much, you know, it's $1,000 a year. Think about it.
Yes.
Yeah.
On average. Now we're vertically integrated, right? So I kept the construction company. So we do all of our CapEx and we do still do some new construction as well.
Yeah.
And then last year we started management as well.
So. Manager, I bet it was the one you forced into it. It wasn't by choice, was it?
No, it wasn't. I mean, look, we tried what everybody else does in the beginning, right? We tried third-party management companies.
Yeah.
You know, there's no perfect one out there.
I know, no, and even doing it yourself, I bet you had your own challenges too. It is not perfect, but I think you can just have, for example, in our case, having the property manager, a regional that's going to share with all the properties, and then you're no longer the priority. And then, you know, hey, I want to implement this. Oh, have to be next week because we slam. And I know, but I feel, and that's the feedback I got from people that went vertically integrated on a property management, is that it's like whatever direction we want, we take it and take action.
Correct. It's much easier to implement things, right? Versus using a third party. It's your company. You know, the company culture, we start that from the beginning. I feel like
That's big.
Yeah. And a lot of the company culture in these third party property managements, it's broken. Like it's no good. You know, they leave them on an island and they don't really support them.
I had a conversation with Ella the other day that one time I jumped on a meeting because I usually don't do my asset management. My wife does, or we have an asset manager, but like I was just listening with the managers. It's like, man, they need a leader.
Correct.
Right? It was just like a wild west out there.
Yeah.
You know, so I commend you for that, man, to take that action, because it's not easy to the numbers that make sense. You have to have enough but since question for you, so you have properties in different states.
Yep.
Does that still work? By how does that logistics work?
Yeah, so I mean, look, we started with Dallas. We took over all our properties in Dallas.
Okay.
You know, we made sure we had the systems in place, we had the team, and now at this point it becomes easier to go into these different states and different locations. You know, unit count matters, right? If you're going to go to somewhere, Georgia, and you've only got 100 units there, it might be tough because you need a regional really to kind of watch over. And but yeah, I mean, now, like I said, we're going to those different states now in different cities. And
yeah, but I believe if you got solid processes and, you know, solid culture, and now, especially after COVID, how much our world became closer by technology or Zoom calls and, you know, those Zooms, like, you know, it kind of helps you on that sense of make sure. And plus on a multifamily, like you tie to the numbers doesn't lie. Right. So if you looking at certain different indicators of it, so it's totally doable.
It is. And I mean, if you've got a good leadership and they know how to lead through virtually, that's essentially what you're saying, right? Yeah. You know, you could definitely push the team. We still mix in. We like having that team culture, like I mentioned. So, I mean, we have company events constantly and we fly everybody in. So we still build that. But yes, a lot of it can be done virtually.
And the relationship face to face.
Yeah.
So cool, man. So cool. So what are you guys' appetite now? What is your project for? Because some of the people I heard that they started on C, B class, and, you know, but you did the construction, the development. Uh-huh. And people that said, once you go development, you're done with the other stuff. So how'd you compare the two?
I don't agree, right? I mean, I think we've always had a good mixture of development and existing multifamily. Right. You know, the development, depending how many units you're building and what you're building, it's going to take you 2, possibly 3 years if you're starting with raw land. You know, you got to get the entitlements and all that.
Yeah.
So I think it's good to mix it up. You know, have a few development projects going while you still got your buying acquisitions and existing multifamily. Mm-hmm. At least it's worked for us. You know, there are obviously you're just developers, which if you've got enough in your pipeline, then it makes sense, right? And then you have some coming online while you're building others.
Right.
But yeah.
Yeah, no, I love that comment because, like, ultimately it's the importance of diversification, right? Yeah. Because you're doing, getting the multifamily operation, all that, which you have huge tax advantages, which in a new construction,
correct. You don't. You lose that, yeah.
Right? And I have solid investors that high incomers, and it's like they need that depreciation. That's why they leverage a lot of that multifamily that wouldn't have, probably would be a higher return, but at the same time, you know what I mean? So to the point that we talk to investors, I'm sure you do this as well, it's like, is diversification is key.
Yeah, that's a good point. It's a different type of investor that invests in development, right? They don't need the cash flow. They want to take that higher risk but higher return. So,
what kind of investor are you? Are you more of the cash flow or are you like bigger returns?
Oh, man, that's a great question. You know, I think in the beginning it was the higher returns, right? You know, the larger value add deals, higher returns. But now it's definitely cash flow.
You know,
I feel like cash flow, if I can hold on to a property for 20, 30 years.
Really?
I would, you know, cash out refi over and over and over.
Yeah. Infinity return, they say, right?
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah, I'm the same way. Like, I talked to Dad, like, we like the total return because you get one big fat check and it's like, yeah, let's go. I'm rich now.
Right.
But, you know, obviously, when you start compiling and deal after deal, and, you know, the cash flow ultimately is higher too, you know, so. And then today's climate is on a multifamily as far as BNC is a little bit tough to get that cash flow. Would you agree?
Going into a new deal right now, it is. It's definitely tough on the cash on cash, but, you know, there's still some markets you can go into and
still kill it.
Yeah. Depending how you structure it.
Sure.
Right?
Sure. 100%. But bro, I really, now in the next segment, I want to ask about how you start all your companies and, you know, about your mastermind. And another question that I want to ask is, like, how you got this amazing marketing skills, which that is an awesome skill set, bro. But guess what time it is?
I have no idea. Coffee?
Los Cubanos, it's coffee time.
Nice, cafecito. Nice.
Subway. Thanks for coming, man. Yeah, pleasure having you. Dude, I'm a little afraid.
Why?
Cubans are known for really good coffee.
I know, I'm excited. I want to see what you got here.
So,
look,
there's no pressure.
Italo is a geek about coffee, right? And this guy just stood up to him. It was almost like a fighter. Say, hey, what you got?
What you got?
Let me see.
You know, it's funny. I praise about coffee, no sugar. Do you put sugar in your coffee?
That's my thing. I do not. I'm a keto, been keto for right on. Long time. So.
But you know, one thing that I'm a sucker for, people are going to kill me out there, be like, talk the talk, but walk the walk. But when I'm in Miami at the airport, one of the things that I love getting there is the cafecito, man.
And they pour the sugar in.
Oh my God. Yeah, that thing, like, it hurts back here. Yeah. Like, but it's so good. Like, you know, the smell.
You know what I envisioned? Like, I know it's kind of a joke, but like, you get the little thing, that cafecito, and then when you drink it, it's almost like a little hand comes out of the coffee and smack you in the head, like, big time.
Yeah. Oh my God,
like,
man.
You know, like, whoa.
But it just,
what just happened?
But it's funny because lately I've been fighting it. Like, as soon as I walk in the airport, I was like, I loved it. Do I still love it?
You gotta try it again.
Yeah, I think I need to go back there.
It's its own unique thing, you know. It's not something that I would drink every day. Yeah. But you know, it's
but
different.
I appreciate it for the culture behind it too. You know, like when you talk to Cubans, how they make their coffee. You know, it's kind of like each country had their cuisine, and like Brazil have our own way to make coffee. You guys have your own way to serve coffee.
Right.
And is that what is the most common in Cuba? It would be the cafecitos or more like the espressos?
No, a cafecito for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cortadito is
what
they call
it. Yeah.
Just a little real dark, strong espresso with a ton of sugar. Yeah.
Gee.
Yeah. Imagine. Let's go. What you got today, man?
So this one in here, again, another one of my finds in there. But this is from Brazil too. But the bag just spoke to me and I was like, he's Cuban. This thing's probably going to have some good flavor. So I made sure that I made on an AeroPress. So it's going to get all that good flavor in there. But it's called Anodyne Coffee. So let's give it a shot, and then I'll talk about it in a little bit. Have you drank this kind of coffee before, like specialty coffee?
Nope.
All right, interesting to see what's your feedback on it. So give it a good smell. You can look on top of it. You can see a little bit of the oils against the light in there. Give it a good smell. You can't really sense a whole lot right now because I think the temperature is still a little bit too high in there.
That's the thing. You have to be open minded. People say, is this a tea? Right? But it.
Yeah, look at the color.
You actually you identify flavors. That like there's a flavor.
Okay.
It's like a good wine. You like wine?
I do. I can't name you good wines, but I do like having a good wine.
Yeah, but you know when you have a good wine and then you get a one that's not so good, it's like, that doesn't sit well.
It's different.
Yeah,
you know, another thing. In the tea, it's like a mixture of tea and coffee.
Right. So whenever you drink, sip on it and let it sit on your mouth for a little bit, and then you can start getting the notes from this.
Let it slide on the side of your tongue. You really and slurp it. That's the secret.
So this one here has a tasty notes of raisin, caramel, and graham crackers. So it's something more bold. I made espresso with this coffee yesterday.
It's too much.
No, it was phenomenal. Like that crema and everything. Yeah. Oof. So. It was interesting to see on the other side too, on a pour, not a pour over, but like a different type of brewing.
The AeroPress.
And the AeroPress.
Yeah. I love AeroPress coffee, dude. It's just really cool. It's this machine that you pour the coffee, turn it over, and then it's like a plunge, like a gigantic syringe kind of thing. And it kind of.
Like, what does it do? Just.
It brews the coffee. Like, it has a little filter. Yeah, so you plunge in, and the water, the coffee keeps coming out. That's really cool.
It's under pressure. So, but as far as coffee goes, do you drink strong coffee? Like on a daily basis, what's your go-to?
So, pretty simple, man. Same coffee every day. It's like a keto mixture of coffee. It's like a bullet. Have you had that?
Yeah. Those things.
Okay, so it tastes really good because it's got a lot of fat in it.
Yeah. But. Dude, that thing is a slap on your face in the morning.
I've seen people get ghee butter and they mix with the coffee. Have you seen it?
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
It gets super oily.
Yeah.
I mean, in coffee... Too much information, I know, but for a lot of people all day, I know you're gonna empathize with me. But coffee in the morning, you drink that coffee, you go to the bathroom, right? That type of coffee with a lot of butter.
Let's go, man.
It's I'm just saying what everybody knows.
Yeah.
You drink.
I also put MCT oil in it, which.
What is that?
It's
MCT.
MCT. It's just a good oil for the body. I don't know, but it also has that effect. It goes straight.
Oh, boom.
Yeah.
you started the day light.
Yeah, man.
Light and bright. But hey, thank you so much for coming here. Hey, but hold on. Did I pass the test?
It was good. Okay. It was good.
Good is good enough for me. Yeah. But George, thank you so much, man. I appreciate you.
Hey, your story is amazing. After the show's off, you ask that question again.
I know. Man,
it really was good. I know it didn't come off that way.
Just kidding, man. Just pulling your leg.
Just taking me a second to process.
Absolutely. Yeah. But thank you so much. Appreciate hearing your story over there. I used to live in Miami myself, so nice. Met a lot of nice Cuban people down there. And but yeah, thanks for having the coffee with us.
Let's go, my brother.
Ciao, ciao in the field. All right, bye.
Hey, guys, real quick before we continue. So if you want to learn a little bit more how to get started and invest in real estate today, please go to their website, multifamilyempire.com. And if you also want to learn how to do the best cup of coffee in your own home, we're going to teach you a lot of tips and tricks. Go to multifamilyempire.com/forward the real grind. Let's get back to that interview.
Need to taste it again.
I know, right? It was like, is it really good? Yeah, I mean, actually, when the temperature drops, actually, you get more flavors. It's incredible,
yeah. Just taste it a little bit better, right?
Yeah. And it, like I said, he even poured on a scale to know the amount of water, the raw temperature. So, and I was talking to this in the other interview, and all the time, you guys listening to this, like, you know, I own a small coffee farm in Brazil. So if you see the process of like how they handcrafted this, dude, it's incredible. Hmm. You change your forever. It's really cool.
Yeah, they don't just throw the coffee beans in.
Yeah, no, it's a big process. But brother, talk to me about, you know, your marketing. Like, you do such awesome marketing. And I'm not talking to marketing. Some people can think, oh, it's like flashy, whatever. I see this as so strategical for you to teach other people. And I believe that's what your goal of teaching other people. Now, how that skill set came in and like all those content and like, you know, you always did an awesome job with that. Is that any?
I really can't give you a good answer there other than, you know, ever since I started the businesses, I've always kind of seen where things are going marketing wise before it happens a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, I was doing YouTube videos and having a YouTube channel on fix and flips back in,
really,
I don't know, was that 2010 or something like that? I mean, the video quality was horrible, and I could play you something, you'd be like, wow. But so yeah, you know, I've kind of see that trend coming. And as far as what you were saying, you know, I don't do it flashy. I just,
absolutely,
somebody told me years ago, it's like, look, you're, and it stuck with me, it's, you're doing things that you think are easy because you're doing it every day, right? Document that and put it out there, and people are going to appreciate it. Like, it's
100%. And you know me, I do have actually a marketing background, and I admire your stuff, you know. But in the way, you obviously, sometimes the negativity starts sometimes in our own family, right? People are like, oh, why are you posting all the time, whatever. But the people that got value out of him, and if you were to hear those testimonies, it'd be like, oh, because you, that day I was having a bad day or something. It was like, man, I drank a coffee, went to work out, and you post that. It's like, man, it just changed my mindset of the day.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, so, you know, that's what I tell people on the marketing side. It's like, bro, like, if you have a product that you want to show out to the world, do it. Because you end up inspiring more people than you think and helping more others. And my philosophy is that you help other people, they'll help you and make you grow. You can grow together.
Yeah, I do think it's a lot with mindset too, right? Like you kind of mentioned. Before, I mean, I wasn't even posting on social media as far as before the business, right? And then I actually saw Gary Vee speak live. It was maybe about 7 years ago or so when I started really doing social media. And, you know, his mindset was, look, I'm doing this for business and to help others. I'm not doing it for any other reason.
Yeah.
And that kind of stuck with me. And I'm like, okay, well, if that's the case, you know. And I actually removed a lot of my friends and family from my social media and started adding more business, you know.
People that would appreciate it. And I was like, it's easy. That's what I said. You don't like what I put out, unfollow me. You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't need to. Like, right? And it's like, oh, this guy says, like, oh, the way you show up on the camera is too masculine. You know what I mean? The ladies wouldn't appreciate it. I was like, what are you talking about, dude? Actually, we have a lot of women in the show. But anyway, fuck, I don't want to get into
this. So a lot of people overthink it too, right?
Yeah, like, overthinking. It was just like, easy, just unfollow. Okay. Yeah. How did you start it? Like, you know, obviously businesses start growing now. So now you have a mastermind, a coaching. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, so the thought was, you know, I was getting a ton of requests because of my social media presence. Sure. And a lot of people sending me deals, wanting to partner and look at the deal. And it was impossible for me to, it didn't make sense for me to, my resources and my company resources to go and look at all those. So what I decided on was, well, you know, if I start a coaching program, I can teach them how to underwrite, what deals to look for, which would make that process even easier. And it would also show that there's some commitment.
Sure.
As well. So that was the thinking. You know, the thinking was, I want to do more deals. There's people out there that want to learn what I'm doing. Let's do it together.
That's awesome there. And when did you start that?
I rolled it out early last year. Haven't done a lot of marketing for it. You know, I've kept it somewhat small. I don't have like coaches underneath me. You know, my team comes in and helps with some things, but for the most part, I'm the coach.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And then the mastermind, a few months after that, last year as well, I partnered with somebody that had already started a mastermind in the single family space. And then they wanted to grow the multifamily space. So they're two separate groups, but kind of together.
Right.
So I came on board and I've been helping with that. And that's great. That's great as well.
And by the way, guys, you listen to this podcast, like, you know, there's going to be a link for all George's program. You know, if you want to go and find out what this guy's doing, which I'm a big follower. And that's awesome, dude. And where is your future the next 5 years? Let's start by the Elevate Investment Firm. Is that your main focus, or you just kind of want to scale all together? It's one big of piece component.
I mean, it all drives Elevate, right? You know, that's that is the main focus. It's building up the portfolio, you know, buying these existing multifamily, building other multifamily. My goal is to continue to grow that portfolio. I've got big numbers, big goals. And then the construction company and the property management company, it just drives that same, you know, drives Elevate.
Would you consider going... retail, like, you know, client space for other clients versus yourself, or just vertically integrated?
We do take third party on the construction company, and we're getting ready to take some third party on the management. You know, we're selective with who we take on, but we do like to have that going as well.
You don't have this pain in the ass owners, right? There would be like,
I didn't say that, but.
I'm kidding. Because, you know, we see a lot of people coming into this industry and begins on the underwriting, especially now when the times now are conservative, right? And, you know, property management cannot make miracles other than just, you know, do the best.
We definitely do ask a lot of details on the management side when it goes to the business plan and the CapEx. And
I think if I ever had a property management company, I would get clients. I was like, let me see your underwriting, your initial underwriting. Yeah. Let me take a look at that.
We do ask for that. So, yeah.
Cool.
I'm with you.
That's awesome, dude. It was like, oh, I'm sorry, but I'm going to decline you as a client.
I mean, we've done a couple, right? Yeah. Where if we don't want them to fail, but at the same time, if they're not capitalizing it right.
Yeah. And also, I mean, your reputation and all that stuff, right? Yeah. I understand. That's cool, man. And develop-wise, is that something that more or less...
Development projects, is everything.
Yes.
I mean, I think it's a really good time for it right now. There's still supply and demand, right? There's still not enough units in certain markets. It's become more difficult to build right now. So the lending is harder.
Yep.
The construction costs have somewhat stabilized, and it's actually come down a little bit this year.
Stress so, products or
product, both labor both. And material.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So that's not the problem. It's more of the lending, and then the fact that some of these developers have got to bring more equity to the table, and they're not used to having to do that. So I do think it's a great opportunity. We've got a couple right now that we're working on. And, you know, you finish in let's say 24 months from now, right? Mm-hmm. The market seems like 2 years from now, it should be starting to creep back up. It's good timing.
Yeah, absolutely, man. And talk a little bit about your family. You've got three beautiful daughters and...
Yeah, I've got my hands full there,
awesome
man.
Wife. I can't relate. You know my story, but like, how was the be a father with three beautiful little girls?
Go ahead.
No, are you like me that everything's pink and everything's Disney? And like, my girls are super girly, dude. Like, I don't, how is your...
My girls are super girly. And yes, I've, you know, more makeup put on me than I ever thought I would and all kinds of stuff.
I love it.
And I'm a good sport, but at the same time, they're awesome athletes too.
Oh, so really?
They play a lot of sports.
So what are their age?
So 10, 8, and 7. Wow. Right now. You know, they're in soccer, volleyball. All three of them are in cheer, which yeah. I had no idea that sport was as crazy as it
is. As competitive
so
as it is.
So competitive, man. So competitive.
Are you cheering also in the crowd? I was like...
Yes.
Yeah. I can totally see myself.
Yeah, I end up doing stunts and stuff with them.
That's great,
you know,
dude.
But it's fun, man. It's fun. They keep me on my toes. I feel like they keep me young for sure.
Oh yeah. And about your wife, how long have you guys been married?
Oh shoot. Man, we've been together since 2001, so, and married,
oh my goodness,
since 06, or
that's 22 years.
Yeah, so it's about, yeah. It's been not 06, 09, my bad, I was off there.
Yeah.
Married since 09, together since 2001.
Yeah.
So you know, a lot of years together. We've been through a lot.
It's okay, guys. We're going to clip this part so he doesn't get in trouble. You know what I mean?
Thank you.
Okay.
So, I mean, she's amazing, man. Everything, the crazy things I've come up with, she's always supported me. You know, when I decided we're gonna move from Miami to Dallas, my family thought I was crazy. They disowned me for a little bit. You know, the Hispanic culture.
You gotta be closer, man.
Yeah.
You gotta be there. A drive away.
Yep. But she was all for it. And then, you know, the construction company, once again, everybody thought I was crazy, but she was supporting me. So, I mean, always, always supporting me. And then she's an amazing mother. Like, the way she takes care of our kids, it's...
That's awesome, dude. Yeah. And now that has... To be involved in so many businesses and, you know, the success you're having, you have to have a good foundation at home, right? And I feel that's awesome, dude. Yep. Congratulations.
Thank you, man.
Yeah. And right now, the guests would like to know a little bit more in detail about Georgia Brew. And that's the part is spilling the beans with Georgia Brew. Look.
I'm nervous.
He's cracking up a lot already, man. Put you on the spot here, bro.
All right.
No. All right. Since you've been involved in construction, Makita or DeWalt?
Makita.
There you go. Pitch roofs or flat roofs?
Ooh, that's a tough one, man. Pitch.
Windows or Mac?
Oh, Windows all day.
Oh, get out of here, man. We're going to stop this show now, guys. Let's just pause
iPhone,
that.
No Mac, no. Sorry.
I knew it was something about you that I didn't like. All right, you have three daughters, and Elsa or Cinderella?
Elsa. Yeah.
All right. Can you sing a song?
You don't want to hear that, man.
Florida or Texas?
Texas all day.
Hey, let's go. TikTok or Instagram?
Instagram. Yeah, I haven't mastered TikTok yet.
Yeah, that means we're getting old.
I know.
Cuban cigar or Caribbean cigar?
I'm sorry, was that a choice? Cuban cigar or Cuban cigar?
Cuban cigar or cigar from Brazil.
Oh, got it. Cuban cigar.
Okay.
Cohiba.
There you go. I didn't know another cigar, so I... At the gym, chest days or leg days?
Chest day.
Chest days, right? Leg days, you'll be like, oh, get out the couch. And that was spilling the beans with Georgia, bro. That was awesome.
Okay, that wasn't too bad.
Bro, thanks so much for coming to the show, man. And I know that you're just like me, like very try to, you know, motivate, learn, sharpen our saw and stuff. I want you, and that's a part of the show, look at the camera. If you could talk to your younger self, what would you have to say?
Oh, man, I would say that, you know, pick that one thing that really drives you and that you're motivated to do and put all your focus in that. Do it the best you possibly can. Don't let all the noise and all the distractions get to you and just go all in. Once you master that skill or that aspect or that part of real estate, then you can get diverse, you know, diversify yourself.
Let's go, man. Dude, thank you so much for being here, my friend.
Thank you, bro.
And this is the Rio Grind. Let's go.
And as always, thank you so much for watching the Rio Grind. And as George just asked, what drives you? I know what drives me, coffee. As long as I have coffee, man, I'm going anywhere. What about you? So remember, give us a like, give us a subscribe, follow us, listen to us on your favorite podcast platform. We're everywhere, sharing the best stories, the best success stories, and I hope we're motivating you because we're motivated that you're watching us. Thank you once again. This is the Rio Grind. Let's go.
Waking up to success. Hey. Now we're getting it started. Hey. This is the Rio Grind. Everything you've been wanting. Building an empire, no question. Talking about real estate, investing, making the millions. No stopping while we sip on, go and make coffee. Hey. The Rio Grind. This is the Rio Grind. Let's go.